2 Corinthians, if you have your copy of God's Word, find your place in 2 Corinthians. Now, I could have picked a lot of text to jump into this series with, but I just chose this one, and it's going to be a springboard to talk about three things this morning. When it comes to family, there's a reason why the Bible is laid out the way it is, and what I'm going to show you in this sermon in particular, but throughout the whole series, as we talk about the role of the husband, the role of the mother, the role of the parents, the wife, the children, all those things, it's all grounded in what I'm going to show you this morning. So if you're not a mom this morning, today you're not going to feel out of place, because today is really about how to approach the Bible. How do you read the Bible as 66 books written by over 40 authors over the span of like 5,000 years? How is it one unfolding story that each little point points to a larger point? I'm going to teach you that this morning. And if you will please really zone in and get this sermon, the value of every other sermon you hear at this church will increase dramatically, the impact that it makes in your life. But if you don't understand this concept, then the other concepts will just seem like more hoops to jump through and more rules and regulations, okay? When the world was created, we see in Genesis 1 and 2, God creates the heaven and the earth, and each day He would make a new thing and bring new order into the created system. And with each day, He would say, "It is good, it is good, it is good." Then on the sixth day, as the crowning work of His creation, He makes man in His own what? Image. Now, the word image there is a word that's used for a reflecting tool, like a mirror. So if you look at a mirror, the mirror is your image bearer. Well, in the same way, when God made Adam, Adam was made to be God's mirror. He was to take the image of God and reflect it back out to God and all the created order. Now, remember, when God made man, God said, "Let us make man in our image." It's plural. Why did He use the plurality there? Well, He's referring to the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit. One God eternally existing in three distinct persons for all eternity. So the triune God existing in community, or if you will, family, as one God, wants to create His image bearer, and he makes man in His image, and He said, with each day, it is good, it is good, it is good. But then He comes down to Adam, and He makes man, and He says of Adam, "It is not good for man to be alone." Now, why would He say that? Because it is impossible, even though Adam was sinless at this point in history, it was impossible for Adam to adequately reflect the nature of the triune God by being a single person. He couldn't do it adequately. So, you know the story. God causes a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and then He takes a rib from sleeping Adam, and the word there, it says, He fashioned Eve. Now, just parenthetically, when He made Adam, the Bible says He formed him of the dust of the ground. But a different word is used when it came to the creation of Eve. It's as if God slowed down, took His time, and fashioned the woman. That's why women are really into fashion, all right? And He makes the woman, He brings the woman to the man. Adam wakes up, he sees Eve for the first time, and the first thing he did was he sang a song. Literally, when you read the text, it's poetry. So he says, "Behold, this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of the man." Now, it's not that catchy in English, but in Hebrew, it's beautiful. He literally sang a song. That is why women dig musicians. And so there you have the creation of the first family, and God puts a stamp of approval on it by saying, behold, it's very good. So now these two people, husband, wife, and then their progeny, can adequately reflect the nature of the triune God more effectively than what Adam could do by himself. You following me up to this point? Yes? Okay. Now, the enemy has already fallen from heaven at this point. Lucifer, the archangel, rebelled against God, and he led one-third of the heavenly host in that rebellion. And he's going to wage war against God, and he chooses to do that by attacking the image bearers, the husband and the wife. So, you know, he tempts Eve. Eve tempts Adam. And they together ate us out of house and home, right? So they sin. God comes down, and God talks to Adam and Eve. And they begin to blame shift. Well, she made me do it. Well, the snake made me do it. You know, all this stuff. And then God says something very important. He says, I'm going to fix all this. Everything that he's done, I'm going to make it right. And I'm going to do it through the seed of the woman. You see, I'm out there in the future sometime. I'm going to provide a Savior, and he will, notice this, it's a male, notice it's the offspring of the woman. He will crush the head of the serpent. He will defeat Satan, and in the process, his heel is going to be bruised. Now, what's he foreshadowing? He's foreshadowing the coming of Christ. He's foreshadowing the cross. That's called the proto-evangel. It's the proto-gospel. So right there in the beginning, God chooses as his image bearer, the man and the wife together, a family, a couple. Satan's first attack was leveled against the pristine image bearer of God, the family. And then God says, my chosen instrument through which I will send redemption, guess what it's going to be? It's going to be a family. I'm going to send my son through the auspices of a married couple. So marriage is a big deal. Family is a big deal when it comes to Scripture. It's not just something that pastors like to harp on. You see, before there was a church, there was a family. Before there was a government, there was a family. And the way that the gospel is best going to be portrayed to a lost world will be through a family. So that's why you see things like in Acts 5, you see these patterns that go all the way through the New Testament, where the Philippian jailer gets saved, the next thing you see is his whole family's coming to Christ. And you see all of these family movements throughout the New Testament. You also see a pattern developing when the apostles are writing. Now, if you're new to church, if you're new to Christianity, the apostles were the early leaders of the church. They were kind of like the pastors of the early church. They wrote letters, or what the text calls epistles sometimes. Somebody told me one time, Pastor, I thought that the epistles were the wife of the apostles. Not true. They are the letters of the apostles. And so these early leaders would write letters to these churches and explain to them how to do life, what to believe, and how to behave. But they followed this really consistent pattern where they would say things like, like in Ephesians, for example, Paul starts out the first five chapters saying, this is what salvation is. Here's who Jesus is, and here's what Jesus has done, and here's how it all worked out. So you need to understand your salvation more than just the ABCs and Vacation Bible School. You need to understand it in depth, have a broad and a deep understanding of salvation. First five chapters of Ephesians is all about the person and work of Jesus Christ, how he saves you. But then in each of the letters, there's a hinge on which the letter turns. It changes gears, and he goes from doctrinal explanation to practical application. And interestingly, not really surprisingly, the first way he always would apply the gospel is to the family. So he would talk about husbands, do this. Wives, do this. Children, do this. Moms, do this. Dads, do this. Grandparents, do this. Why? Because that was God's first way of reflecting his image. It was the first thing that Satan attacked. And it was the way that God said, in the future, through the auspices of family, I am going to rub in the face of Satan how I'm going to take everything that's wrong in Eden and make it right in a new heaven and a new earth. So you read Ephesians, you read Colossians, you read Titus, you read Timothy. You're going to see those same paradigms of gospel and family. Gospel and family. And as believers in Christ, you're not supposed to open the Bible and just look for a new rule. You're supposed to understand that the little story is pointing back to a bigger story, and it only makes sense when it's fleshed out that way. Today, I'm going to show you how that works for the family. So whatever your role in the family is, there's three things that the gospel serves to give you that if you don't get this, the Christian norms. Luther called it the Hausstaffel, or the household rules. You find these in several different books in the New Testament. If you don't understand what I'm going to teach you today, then next week's going to be very difficult to wrap your mind around. So here's what he teaches you, that it is imperative that you let the bucket of your heart down into the well of the gospel before you try to make application of these rules. And if you don't get that, then everything else is just going to seem like one more religion. You might as well be Catholic, might as well be, Hindu. You can be whatever religion. It's just, religion is just a lot of rules that's supposed to make God happy. That is not what Christianity is. Christianity is a grace-based relationship through which God changes us and changes the world over time. So you've got to let the well of the bucket of your heart into the well of the gospel if you're going to get family and do family right. And if you can get that, not only will this be the best Mother's Day you've ever had, it will make church a revolutionary experience for you. Three things. Number one, the gospel is an example to follow. Let me read from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. Look at what Paul is saying. I'm not going to give you the whole context of what he's saying. I just want you to understand this one thought, because this thought comes up again and again. Paul says, "And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord," so we're looking at the person of Christ, "are being transformed into the same image." We become like Jesus by looking at Jesus from one degree of glory to another. So this is a statement he's making. He makes it in several different ways, in several different letters. We look at Jesus, and as we study Jesus, Jesus changes us. And he's saying that's the key to Christianity. That's how it fleshes out in your life, okay? How does that work? Number one, the gospel is an example to follow. So the writers give the gospel. And when I say gospel, I'm not talking about a style of music, all right? When I say gospel, the word means good news, and it refers primarily to the work of Jesus on the cross, that he died for our sins, he was buried, and he was raised. But more broadly, it refers to God's overarching plan of redemption and how he's going to set right what went wrong in Eden, and the person of Jesus, who he was, what he did, and his work, specifically on the cross. When I say gospel, that's what I meant. The scripture uses it to say, here is an example that you can follow. Now, let me make a few examples of that. One, when it comes down to the husband-wife relationship. Rather than just saying, husbands, love your wives, Paul grounds that argument in an example. He says, husbands, love your wives, specifically the way that Jesus loved the church and laid down his life for the church. You familiar with that? You know what I'm talking about? So the particulars of that, you're going to be in a lot of situations to where you're going to look at it and say, now, how am I supposed to love her in this situation? And Paul said, rather than giving you a list of 100 particulars, I'm going to give you one principle and say, always filter how you love her through how Jesus loved the church. How did he love the church? He saw the church lost. He saw the church hurting. He comes down. He dies on the cross for the church to redeem the church by his own shed blood. He was buried and he was raised again. So while we were yet sinners, out of unconditional love, Jesus came down and died for us. And he says, now, whatever the situation is, filter your response through that. This week, one particular day, you know, it was just one of those days. It was like a Monday, two or three days. We had like two or three Mondays this week, it felt like. Nobody's fault. It's just that when things broke, three things broke. When planning or calendar mistakes happened, two or three of them happened. So this particular day, I was there, and it all kind of happened. And I go out to my place where I meet with God. I'm on my back porch. I'm sitting in the rocking chair. And when I'm a little upset, I rock faster, you know. And I'm rocking and I'm talking to the Lord. And I'm saying, Lord, how am I supposed to shepherd her and love her through this situation? And this is what I do. I don't know how you do it, but sometimes I offer God a couple of options. So, Lord, maybe I should be her coach. Maybe if I go back in there and I try to give her a pep talk, and then show her the game plan and get her back on track, maybe that would help her. And then I thought, another option, Lord, just in case that doesn't work for you, maybe I should be her teacher and show her where she went wrong and how we could keep that from happening again. And God took my heart, my mind, back to the gospel and said, husband, love your wife the way Christ loved the church. Now, in this situation, what does that look like? And for me, it meant you need to self-sacrificingly go back and serve and love her and offer to help. And in different situations, it fleshes out in different ways. But that's how the example of the gospel, the person and work of Jesus, was the well in which I let the bucket of my heart down in to bring up truth for the moment. Another one is, as I was just praying through this and asking God, how can I explain to my church how the gospel applies to all these different areas of life? This one came to mind. Tell them about adoption. In the early church, the church grew ridiculously fast. I mean, you're going from like a few Jews on a hillside to it's the legal national religion of the Roman Empire. That's big. I mean, wouldn't you love to have a business grow that fast in 3 years? I mean, it's huge. And how did that happen? Well, historians, specifically when you read non-Christian historians trying to explain how it happened, it's fascinating because here's what they recognize that sometimes we miss. The Roman Empire had laws that would allow them, if they had a child that they did not want, they could take that child, and it was just called exposure. They would take the child and put the child in a field and kind of give it over to the gods. And if the gods want the child to live, the child will live. But if not, some animal would come and eat the child. So often what would happen is if it was not the preferred gender. They preferred males. They wanted to have boys. And so if little girls were born into the family, we have letters One in particular from Seneca, where he was saying, if we have a son, take care of him till I return. If it is a girl, expose her. Just throw her away. If the child was born complete, then let's train that child up. Let's keep that child. That's our inheritance. But if the child is deformed or not all there, then put them in a field somewhere. Well, Christians who believe the gospel would be walking down the path and they would hear a baby girl crying over in a field. They would go and they would see this baby girl laying there naked and exposed and helpless. And they would remember that they too were one day helpless, that they too were needy, that they were helpless. But the Lord Jesus Christ came and adopted them into the family of God. So they would pick these little girls up. Now, it wasn't a plan. It wasn't like some pastor came along and started a new program and said, okay, we're going to start the adoption protocol now. It wasn't like that. It was very intuitive and organic. They would just go and find these little girls and say, that little girl was made in the image of God. She deserves to live. They would raise these little girls up. Now, they were raised in a Christian household, and guess what religion they happened to choose as they grew older? They were Christians. Leper colonies existed. These leper colonies, if you were found to have lesions on your body, you were sent into a leper colony and you were left to die. The same thing would happen as different plagues would sweep across the world, bubonic plague, black plague, those kind of things. And they would put all these sick people together and just leave them to die. But the Christians who saw in those people an expression of themselves, we too were dead in our trespasses and sins. We're going to go and we're going to serve these people and love these people and help these people find some meaning in their life, even in this horrible scenario. People would say, but you know you're going to catch it, right? And you're going to die. But because of the gospel, which gave them hope of resurrection and new life, death wasn't that big a deal. They could walk into a threatening situation. Very often, what would happen with a little bit of medical care, a little bit of hope, a little bit of love, 70% of those leper colonies would survive and be healed of that disease or that plague. What religion do you suppose these former pagans would then choose for the way that they would live? Christianity. You see, it wasn't so much just mass evangelism, although that was a big part of the growth of Christianity. It wasn't just procreation that Christian couples had kids and those kids were raised in Christian homes. But it was the way they followed the example of the gospel and things like adoption and things like reaching out to the least of these, the sick, the hurting, that caused Christianity to go from a marginalized peasant religion to the faith of the Roman Empire, to where Caesar himself claimed faith in Jesus Christ. You too are to look to the gospel in myriads of ways. When it comes to giving, notice that the apostles, when they're trying to get people to be faithful to give, they wouldn't say things like, you ought to be so embarrassed if you don't give. You ought to feel so bad, shame on you if you don't give. They would say things like, thanks be unto God for his indescribable gift. They would show us the gospel. And they would say, you know, God's the biggest and best giver. Look at his example. He gave Jesus. And you'd go and do likewise. You give your first and your best back to the Lord. And he would ground the motive for giving in the gospel. So there's examples to follow. Secondly, the gospel is a motive to foster. When you're trying to change people, there's a variety of different motives you can use that you believe will bring about change. So, for example, if you're a parent, There's a sense in which you're trying to bend the twig so that by the time it's a tree, it's leaning in a certain direction, right? And so you employ different tactics to that end. My dad preferred pain. He would just wear me out. And my dad was one of these dads, boy, go tear me a stick off that hickory tree, bring it over here to me. I had to cut my own stick that he hit me with. You know, I mean, it was bad, man. It was back in the Bible times, you know. And so I would go, and I would always pick the littlest one, and daddy'd say, try again. And I would bring it back to him, and then he would whip me with that hickory stick, and then he would say, you better hush. You know what's coming next? Or I'm going to give you something to cry about. You're going to get another one. Dad just believed in pain, man. He wasn't abusive, any of that kind of stuff. But man, he just believed that enough pain. I hear myself saying this. Sometimes Dad would say things like, well, are you rebellious or just stupid? Because this ain't working for you, boy, you know. Eventually, you're going to wise up. And so Dad believed that pain changed the person, right? Some parents believe in shame. They don't, we're not going to hit our child. That's our little child, but we'll shame them to death. And sometimes I wonder which one's worse. Honey, you disobeyed. So go put the dunce cap on and take time out. Sit over here in the corner. Put your nose in the corner. Now put it right in the corner. Just shaming them. And then as they get older and then you can't set them in a corner anymore, you emotionally shame them. You give them the silent treatment. You put them in an emotional corner. And you just show them, Mom is so disappointed. I expected so much more. For some, it's pride. For some, they motivate by pride. Well, you're my son, and in my household, you. Now, there may be a time that any one of those could be useful, and we'll talk about some of those ethics in Scripture as we get into this series. You got to be here the whole series. You're not allowed to miss, by the way. But if you do miss, you got to listen to it online. This is a powerful series. All of those ethics could be fleshed out, but the gospel is portrayed as the greatest way to bring about heart change and life change. Here's how it works. When Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount, his first big sermon, right? He's preaching the Sermon on the Mount, and it was different in its content, but in its organization, its structure, it was typical of a Hebrew sermon. If we read it as Americans, it's very disjointed. It seems like he's bouncing from topic to topic to topic and just saying a few little words about it and moving on. But the way you read a Hebrew sermon, none of it really connects until the conclusion. The conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount is when Jesus says, there's two paths, there's two ways, there's two trees. All right, so that's his conclusion. So what the listener is supposed to do is take these two paths, these two ways, and these two trees, and go back through everything he said about marriage and prayer and giving and apply the two paths, two ways, two trees. What does that mean? That means what Jesus did when he was talking about prayer, he didn't say, there's some people who pray, there's some people who don't pray. What Jesus said was, there's two ways to pray. Some people pray in order for people to hear them. They make long words, and they pray in very eloquent fashion. But there's another way to pray, a better motive in prayer. You go in your closet, and you pray to your Father who hears in secret. It's a different way to pray. There's two ways to give. Some people give, they throw their money into the coffer, and they make a big show out of their giving, but there's another way to do it. Another way to do it. By the way, they have their reward in full. The applause of the crowd, that's their reward. So whatever they gave, that's what they were paying for, is the applause of men. But then there's you. who follow me. You give in secret. The left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. You give in secret, and you trust that your Father who sees in secret is going to repay you. As you're discipling your children and you're training your children, don't miss that. Don't miss that is the motive you want to foster in their heart. You want to show them a sincere walk with the Lord, not obeying as eye service, but as unto the Lord. You want to foster that motive and remind them that God is a loving God, a just God, and He's a God who will honor your obedience to Him. Sometimes, as I look back on things I've discovered like that in my Christian walk and as a parent, I think, oh man, I feel like maybe we've missed it in so many ways, and we've erred on the side of training them in shame or pride or pain or reward or whatever it might have been. But the coolest thing as a parent, how many of you have a parent, have a child who's under 12? Raise your hand. Okay, let me just say a word to you specifically. The coolest thing in the world as a parent is when you get to the point that your kids are speaking the gospel back to you. It's the coolest thing in the world. I remember one time in particular, and I could give several of these, but I remember one time in particular where my son had been in a bully experience and all this kind of stuff, and he comes to me and he says, Dad, you know, this older kid in the neighborhood was picking on me, and, you know, how am I supposed to handle that? And I said, well, son, you hit him right in the nose, and you put your weight into it, you know? And I said, if you hit him right, he'll go down. Then you just ground and pound, you know, that's what you do. And I was kind of mad, and I'll never forget, he said, is that what Jesus wants me to do? And I'm like, probably not, you know, probably not. But if Jesus' way doesn't work, try this one. You know, I didn't say that. And so we go back to the gospel as an example. How did Jesus treat the bullies? You see what I'm saying? So we use that as an example. And when you start hearing them correcting you with the gospel, you're getting somewhere. It's a better motive. It's a better example. And thirdly, it's a power to find. You see verses that will be difficult for you if you don't understand this. Romans 2:4, Paul says that it's the kindness, God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance. And I always would read that and think, how does that even work? Because, again, I was raised by a parent who pain leads you to repentance. So the threat of hell, you know, that makes sense to me. You know, you don't want to be a crispy critter for eternity? Get saved, you know. I get that. That makes sense to me. And that can be a good motive. Whatever it takes to get you to Jesus, I understand. But then there will be things that it's the love of God that compels us. It's the kindness of God that leads us to repentance. And I didn't really understand mathematically how that worked in real life. And later in life, I began to understand it a little better. Let me see if I can explain it to you, and we'll be done. One of the Puritans, Thomas Chalmers, the Puritans always had these cool titles for their books, you know, The Expulsive Power of a New Affection was the title of one of his books. Here's what he said, and it sums up the point really well. He says, it's seldom that any of our bad habits disappear by mere process of natural extinction. He's saying, you got habits and hang-ups and sin patterns, they don't just go away. They're not going to just go away. At least, it is very seldom that this is done through reasoning or by the force of mental determination. Modern psychologists would say, habits are never, they're never stopped, they're only replaced. You can replace a habit, you can't just stop a habit. He goes on. But what cannot be destroyed may be dispossessed. One taste or preference or affection may be made to give way to another. Then he gives this example. He says, so a young man that idolizes pleasure, and what he means by pleasure is riotous living, partying. So a young man who idolizes partying may cease from it or from seeking it because he discovers that it is draining him of his wealth. Some of us have lived through that. We understand. We kind of had that season in life where we just, man, we live from one party to the next. And then the next thing you know, you can either party or you can be rich, but you can't be, you know, rich and party at the same time. One kind of kills the other. The way you live in the party lifestyle really costs you a lot of money in the long run. So the love of money can cause a young man to sober up and live right. Do you see what he's saying here? He goes on, and he says, and then perhaps his love of money is driven out by his worship of ideology or politics. So the young man is growing. He's had that partying stage where he just, man, lived the riotous lifestyle, but he's going broke. He likes money, so his affection for money drives out his affection for partying. But as he gets older, he starts to realize the world's a big place, and he would like to have an impact on the world. He believes some things. He wants to see his worldview disseminated throughout the people that he knows. And so he wants to get involved in something that's going to make lasting change. So he moves toward politics, but it's going to cost him money. But now the greater affection for ideology drives out his love for money. It's worth it, perhaps, he says, to make a difference. I was thinking about, as I was studying through this, John Lennon. You know, John Lennon starts his career with bubblegum pop. He's, I want to hold your hand. That was the deepest thought he had, you know. I want to hold your hand. But then, as he grows older and develops some ideology, he writes Imagine. One, love, passion, is driven out by one that he, in his mind, reckons as weightier, more significant. Pastor, what's this got to do with the gospel? Let me show you. The gospel, when it comes into your life, it becomes the object of greatest gravity. It's the sun which the planets, the issues of your life, revolve around. The reason our solar system is a system is because it's held in order by an object of greatest gravity, greatest pull. When the gospel, your love of God, your love of Christ, becomes that object of greatest gravity, and everything else you're into orders itself around that, you find that not overnight, but over the long haul, the other idols of your life are driven out. Now, this is hard to explain until you've experienced it, but the best illustration I've ever found of this was in a movie, a Vietnamese movie. And by the way, Vietnamese, Asian movies in general are very hard to find in digital media. So if you want to see this one, you're probably going to have to get out the VHS player, all right? It's just hard to find it online anywhere, but the movie was called Three Seasons, and it was released in 1999. It won all sorts of awards, the Cannes Film Festival, and all these different things. In the movie, it was shot in Vietnam, and it was set in Hanoi, and it was about a rickshaw rider. Now, a rickshaw is one of those three-wheeled vehicles that are kind of like taxis that you know, the driver is pedaling the taxi. And this rickshaw rider's name was Hai, H-A-I. And Hai was the lowest position. The rickshaw riders were the lowest positions on the food chain in Vietnam. And at one point, he gives a ride to this beautiful lady named Lan, L-A-N, who had just finished her job at one of the nicest hotels there in Hanoi. Hai would give her this ride from her neighborhood that she lived in to this beautiful hotel, and then the next morning he would give her a ride home. They would chit chat, And over the course of time, he just became infatuated with her. He fell in love with her. Classy, well-dressed lady going into this elegant hotel. And he never really understood what her job was. Until at one point, he had dropped her off one night, and he was having coffee or tea across the street, and he was talking to another rickshaw rider, and the other rickshaw rider says, "Why, you fool, she obviously is a woman of the night. She's a prostitute, and she's doing her job in this hotel." And but at that point, his heart was gone. He loved her. And he remembered that she would talk about on her ride home how great it would be if she could only stay in that hotel as a regular client, as a regular customer of the hotel, and rent one of the nice rooms and order a room service. That would be so cool if I could just order room service and enjoy a meal and really enjoy a good night's sleep and get up the next day and order room service again. And they would laugh back and forth about it. Well, at a certain point in the movie, High competes in a rickshaw race. All the rickshaw riders line up, and they're going to race around Hanoi, and the winner wins this huge prize. It was a big deal in the movie. Long story short, he wins. He gets, you know, thousands of dollars in our vernacular, and that's his chance to buy his way into a sustainable life. He could get an education. He could go to school, you know, doesn't have to do the rickshaw anymore. What do you think he does? He buys a room in the hotel. He goes and picks up the girl, Lan. He takes her to the room. He gives her the money that she would have otherwise made for that night. And then the cinematography is really awesome because in the movie, you know, it's setting you up to believe, all right, get the remote handy, find the fast forward button, there's kids present, you know, and it, you kind of see it, kind of you think it's going to get steamy and all that. But it doesn't. He goes and he sits down beside her and he says, "Lan, you remember that day when I was taking you home and we laughed about how awesome it would be if you could have a, if you could just be a regular customer here in the hotel and how you'd order room service and all that?" And she said, "Yes." And he says, "That's my gift to you." And that's what he did with his winnings. He bought her the room. He ordered room service. They just talked. Nothing happened. The next morning, she had a good night's sleep. The next morning when she woke up, he ordered breakfast in bed for her. And it was a totally beautiful, innocent evening. He takes her home. But then when he goes to the next few days, he goes back to the stop where he always picks her up, and she's not there. Day goes by, another day goes by, a week goes by. He's starting to get concerned about this girl that he had grown to love. And he talks to her friends, and he finds out the building that she lives in, and he goes and he finds her apartment. He knocks on the door to check on her. She comes to the door. She sees who it is, and she says, "I am furious with you, and I never want to see you again." He says, "Why? I only did an act of kindness. I only tried to show you my love, and why would that make you upset with me?" She says, "Do you realize what you did ruined me?" She said, "I'd never been treated like that before. And I cannot go back to my old job because of what you did for me that night. I'll never look at that place the same way again. And now what am I going to do? How am I going to survive?" When I first heard that story, I thought, that's it. That's how the love of God is supposed to work. That's how the gospel becomes the power for life change. It's not saying, "You ought to stop that. Aren't you ashamed of yourself? God's going to zap you. If you don't change, this will happen to you." It's not a business agreement where, okay, if you'll change, God will reward you. It's primarily a new love that pushes out the old. The power of an expulsive affection. And I thought to myself, I wonder if any of you have ever been ruined by the love of God. Has the gospel coming into your life become so significant, so weighty, that other things can't stay any longer? So, where you used to love riches, now you found that you've got eternal riches in the person of Christ, and the meek will inherit the earth. And what more could be added to that? So your love of wealth is pushed aside. Maybe your ambition to day and night constantly do everything you can to build wealth, now you find yourself resting one day in seven. You find yourself intentionally undermining the bottom line by giving away, by helping those in need, by being generous. What happened? Did you read a rule book? No, a new love, a weighty love with greater gravitas drove out the old idol. And subject by subject, as you grow old, beholding the glory of the Lord, we're changed from one degree of glory to the next. And that's how the Christian life is supposed to work. And when you've tasted that, you begin to parent that way. And you begin to do marriage that way. And you begin to look at your parents that way. And over the next few weeks, we're going to unpack each one of those. We're going to resolve everything on Father's Day. Don't miss a sermon. Because everything I've explained this morning, we're going to get very specific into what does that look like if you're the wife, the mom, the dad, the husband, son, daughter, grandparent, single adult. The gospel has implications for whatever your place is in life. And this series shows how God takes the imperfect family and says, you're perfect to display my glory and my gospel. Let's pray. Some of you today, you need to trade in your rule book and get a relationship. That's the nature of the gospel. He doesn't come to you and say, if you fix all this stuff, I'll love you. He says, I love you. And then over time, things begin to change. He wants that to start today. If God has shown you that today, if you're like me, I'd grown up in church. I'd heard the Bible all my life from like the age of 6 or 7 on. But when I heard the reality of what the gospel really is about, it was almost like a brand new religion. It was like something I'd never heard before. There are people in this room that are going through that now. And you may be ready today to kind of seal the deal and say, I'm ready to profess my faith in Christ. Others of you, you're not there yet. And I'm here to tell you, I'm not rushing you. I'm not going to compel you by guilt or shame or any of that stuff or fear. But I am going to tell you, I've been there. I've done that. I've never regretted the decision to follow Christ. Others of you, you're here today and you say, I need to be a part of a church that gives life. One that doesn't beat me up, but builds me up. One that shows me how to follow Jesus through the gospel rather than through works. And I need to work from the gospel, not for the gospel. And today I understand that, and I want to unite with this church family. If that's where you're at, in just a moment I'm going to pray a short prayer. And whatever your decision is, I invite you to come and just let me or one of these other pastors know, hey, I need to get saved, or hey, I need to join the church, or our family needs to join the church. Whatever it is, Maybe today you say, I need to get baptized and just go public with my faith. He died publicly for me. I need to live publicly for him. Whatever it is, I invite you to come if God's speaking to you. Lord, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would speak to our heart, change our life, and draw us to be more like Jesus. Speak to those who are being led to make a decision this morning. Give them the courage to come. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let's stand to our feet. As we stand, you come.